Welcome again to another research session, another fantastic research session where we get to hear from the medical students and the great research that they've been doing. So Varun is our first presenter today and is going to present on creating guidelines for failed fundoplication. So you can take the screen, Varun, and head off.
The topic I'm going to be presenting on is creating guidelines for failed fundoplication. And I'd just like to acknowledge that this is a collaborative project with Mr. Cohen as a team lead and other contributors, including Geordie Elliott, Natasha Newman, and Chelsea Lund, who will be presenting later today on the project. And she completed a lot of the initial groundwork before I joined the project earlier this year. So gastroesophageal reflux disease is one of the common conditions that affects approximately 10 to 20% of the world. Typically presents with symptoms such as heartburn, regurgitation, chest pain. Most patients' symptoms will be well controlled with lifestyle changes like optimizing the diet and pharmacological therapy, such as proton pump inhibitors, histamine receptor inhibitors. However, a small proportion of patients, mainly with refractory GORD, may require treatment with surgical and or endoscopic intervention that consists of things like anti-reflux procedures like fundoplication and hiatal hernia repair, and then other options like endoscopic techniques such as radiofrequency ablation, and then pneumatic dilatation are also other options that are used, as well as bariatric surgical options such as things like a Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. So fundoplication is one of the ways that we can kind of permanently treat GORD. It's a technique that involves wrapping the fundus of the stomach around the lower esophageal sphincter, and that reinforces the weak sphincter pressure and kind of prevents the reflux of stomach contents back into the esophagus. So this allows sufficient pressure to prevent the reflux of the acid and then basically permanently prevents the reflux. There's three main approaches that you can see that are mainly used for fundoplication. The kind of most common one is the Nissen, which is a 360-degree wrap where the fundus of the stomach fully wraps around the esophagus. And then there's others such as a toupee, which is 270-degree wrap, and then a door, which is 180 degrees. So after this kind of procedure is done, approximately 3 to 30% of patients continue to experience GORD symptoms as well as dysphagia following their primary fundoplication. Some of the anatomical reasons for the failure is things like a hiatal hernia, a slipped or misplaced wrap, as well as an excessively tight wrap. However, the decision to reoperate is purely based on symptom recurrence and its effect on patient's well-being. So if the patient's having symptoms such as dysphagia or reflux or regurgitation, that's one of the indications to kind of reoperate on the primary fundoplication. Reoperation rates vary depending on the site, but it's approximately 5%, give or take. And there are currently no established international guidelines for the management of failed fundoplications, which is what we're trying to address. So we're reviewing the existing literature and developing guidelines for the management of failed fundoplication in accordance with the SAGE's standard operating procedure methodology and SAGE's the Society of American Gastrointestinal and Endoscopic Surgeons Society. So this is the kind of methodology that's outlined in the standard operating procedure. So the first step, is generating the key questions using the PICO format, so population interest, intervention, comparative outcome interest. And then so generating key questions and then defining the inclusion and exclusion criteria, and then conducting a literature search based using at least 4 databases using appropriate search criteria, and then doing an abstract review by calibrating all the members and then doing the initial abstracts together and then reviewing all of them to make sure they fit the key questions and the inclusion exclusion criteria. And then doing the same thing with a full text review to make sure that all the texts fit the inclusion exclusion criteria of the key questions. And then step 5 and step 6 include data extraction and then quality analysis. So data extraction using standardized tables to kind of extract all the relevant data from the articles that we need. and then assessing the quality of each of the texts. Mostly we used a Newcastle Ottawa scale because most of the texts were retrospective kind of case control or case series, but there were, you know, a couple of cohort studies and RCTs as well that we used other methods to assess. And then step seven, we do a meta-analysis is performed by the biostatistician, and that is to obtain the relative or absolute effect based on the outcome, if possible, and then a follow-up literature search just to make sure we haven't missed anything since the start of the systematic review. And then step eight is just producing the systematic review and then publishing it, and then 9 and 10 are developing the guidelines, and then the rest of it is just the committee, the SAGES committee, reviews the guidelines, suggests edits, and then eventually gets voted on and then hopefully approved. So during the last year, when I've worked on the project, we've been completing steps 5 and 6, and that's primarily what we'll be focusing on in today's presentation. So these are the key questions that we worked on. So questions 2, 3, and 4, there were kind of only a few relevant articles that were included in the literature search, from the literature search. So mainly we worked on KQ1, which is in adults with new or worsening dysphagia who have had a previous fundoplication, should revision of fundoplication be used or pneumatic dilatation be used? And then there's also, you know, the other ones, so like high volume center versus low volume center, should use Streda or do another fundoplication for post fundoplication heartburn, and should we assess the esophageal length before doing the revision of fundoplication? So the data extraction that we did, basically we had standardized tables to kind of extract, first of all, objective outcomes such as mortality and then morbidity using the Clavy and Dindo classification, and then also using symptoms, symptomatic outcomes, extracting them, so scores for symptomatic outcomes such as dysphagia, regurgitation, heartburn, and we also tried to extract standardized scores from things like the Eckard and the gastroesophageal reflux disease health-related quality of life score, which are like standardized scores that are often kind of measured in these studies. So we tried to extract them as well using the same standardized table. So you can see here, this is from COVID and the software that we used. This is the kind of tables that we had to fill out for each article. And this is from KQ1. So you can see redo fundoplication versus pneumatic dilatation. And this is the objective scores. And we had the symptom scores. And then we had like pre-op versus 3 months post-op, 6 months post-op, 3 years post-op, and then reoperation and then reflex scores based on standardized. And then with the quality assessment we did, we mainly used in Newcastle, Ottawa, because most of them were case series and case controls. And so basically we go through and we assess them for selection bias, comparability bias, and exposure bias, and come up with like a risk of bias for each of the subsections, either low, high, unclear, and then an overall risk of bias as well. You can see here. So results. So because the meta-analysis is yet to be performed, we don't have formal results from the extracted data and quality analyses, but I have included some general observations and findings commented on by some of the investigators. So first things from the data extraction, first thing I wanted to talk about was just some of the stratification of the data by a symptom was kind of unclear. So the data was presented and analyzed usually as a single group with minimal subgroup analysis. So I'll give you an example. This is a case series from 2005 that looks at the outcomes following revision of fundoplication. You can see that there's a table for postoperative complications here. But our question specifically looks at patients with redo because of dysphagia following primary operation. And this is like the complications for all patients, not just people who have had dysphagia. So it's hard to kind of extract any data for symptom-specific patients. So that's why we couldn't really fill a lot of those tables. The other thing was that there was a lot of variability in methodology for symptom assessment and severity. So most studies used Likert scores, which is like a zero to four kind of outcome, where zero is like the symptom doesn't exist. So they're asymptomatic, and then one is like minimal symptoms, and then two, three, and four are just increasing severity. But there were some that had like binary outcomes where it was just they had dysphagia and then they didn't have dysphagia. And then some of them, there was like a continuous scale. So there was a great variability in the methodology for symptom assessment. So it was hard to kind of determine where to draw the line as to, you know, this patient is symptomatic, whereas this patient isn't. That was another issue that we had. So you can see on the left, this is the same paper from before. The dysphagia is measured on the Likert score. And these are all patient filled, so you can see the patient. So the patient basically just circles a number they think best applies to them. And then this one is just like the telephone interview, where they just ask them whether they have dysphagia or not. So there's a lot of different outcomes. There's a lot of different kind of ways in which it was measured. So it's hard to measure. It's hard to kind of compare the two because they were measured. The last thing I want to talk about was just there's a disproportionate number of studies for one arm. So like for key question one, we had a lot of studies for fundoplication, but not many for pneumatic dilatation. So it's kind of hard to compare the two when there's a great volume of data for one arm versus not much for the other. From the quality assessment point of view, the kind of main observation that we had was that most of the prevalent study, the most prevalent study design was just a case series. And this translated to a low quality of evidence.
It's not our brand. I wasn't sure if you knew. It was from our center.
So because, you know, it was a case series, the quality of evidence was pretty low in general. And there was a lack of control arm in the majority of studies. So, you know, in that well-known hierarchy of evidence, we know that case series are fairly low and therefore provide a generally lower quality of evidence. And also using the grading of recommendations, assessment, development, and evaluations framework, which is a grade framework, which assesses the totality of evidence, we saw that, you know, because a lot of them were case series, they had, you know, very low to low kind of certainty evidence. And so therefore they have like a high risk of biases and risk of selection bias and stuff like that. So the overall quality of the evidence was pretty low in general. We also found that there's a poorly reported ascertainment of exposure. So the methodology in which the exposure was reported, so the way in which they asked whether someone had symptoms varied a lot, like I discussed before. And this is also relevant in the quality assessment because we don't know how to compare the two if they're measured differently. So we've covered this before, but it's important to note that it also affects the quality assessment because then there are varied definitions of what constitutes a case and what doesn't, etc. And then the last thing I wanted to mention was just that the follow-up times were a bit unstandardized and there was little analysis of patients left to follow up. So they're often reported as mean plus standard deviation, the follow-up time, which means that every paper has a different follow-up time recorded and it's difficult to evaluate the failure rates and the symptom recurrence without a standardized time frame. So in our standardized tables, we had like follow-up time 3 months afterwards, 6 months afterwards, three years afterwards. But then a lot of the papers just reported follow-up times like with a mean of 32 months plus minus 6 months standard deviation. And so not many papers reported the outcomes at the regular intervals. So it's hard to kind of work out the time needed for a patient to become symptomatic. And then afterwards, they might need a redo fund application. So that kind of reduces the quality of the studies as well. That's basically it. So we used a well-established and internationally accepted methodology to create for the creation of surgical guidelines. So we're creating the guidelines for the management of failed fund application. And at this stage, we've completed the data extraction and quality assessment. So overall, the quality of evidence of the literature has been low due to the choice of the study design and the assessment of subjective measures such as symptomology is generally poorly described in the review articles. But we are awaiting the next steps to do things like a meta-analysis and then possibly conduct a systematic review. So those are our next steps at the moment. That's where we're up to. There's my reference.
Thanks very much, Varun. Any questions for Varun? I was just going to ask one, Varun, if your next step is to do a meta-analysis, how do you find better quality studies to do the meta-analysis on?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think in the literature search that we did, I wasn't a part of the project when we did do the literature search, but I think the literature search kind of they went through and found all the relevant articles. I don't think there's many better articles. You know, the quality of evidence isn't great, but I think that's kind of what we're working with, or we have to work with. So I think the meta-analysis will just be made based on the results
at the moment. Gotcha. Okay, well, thanks very much. That was a great piece of work. I'll get you to unshare so we can get our second speaker. Yijie's here now, I gather. Yep, great.
Hello.
And she's going to talk about patient selection for primary debulking versus interval debulking surgery, a review of current guidelines for epithelial ovarian cancer.
Well, thank you very much, everyone, for the opportunity to present today on my project, patient selection for interval debulking surgery in ovarian cancer, a review of current guidelines. So for a bit of background, ovarian cancer often refers to ovarian, tubal, and primary peritoneal, or OTP cancer, and it's the deadliest gynecological malignancy with a five-year survival of only 48% in Australia. Of all the histological subtypes, the most common is epithelial ovarian cancer, or EOC, which accounts for more than 90% of diagnoses. The treatment of EOC traditionally involves offering surgery first. So patients will receive upfront or primary debulking surgery, and then that's followed up with adjuvant chemotherapy. But more recently, an alternative has emerged, which involves offering patients chemotherapy first. So they'll receive neoadjuvant chemotherapy and then go on to receive interval debulking surgery. So that pathway is known as NACT and IDS. So emerging evidence supports the efficacy of this pathway of treatment, but the question still remains as to which patients should receive surgery first and which patients should receive chemotherapy first. So clinically, decisions about which pathway each patient should go down tends to be fairly subjective and sort of based on gut feel. And so we wondered if there is a consensus on patient selection criteria for each pathway of treatment. So the aim of this study was to review and compare Australia's current clinical practice guidelines on patient selection for either pathway with international guidelines and assess congruence. We compared guidelines from the US through the NCCN, SGO and ASCO, from Europe through the ESMO-ESGO guidelines and the BGCS from Britain, and compared that with our most recent Australian guidelines from Cancer Australia. We looked at which patient, disease, and investigation and treatment or management characteristics contribute to selecting which patients should receive chemotherapy first compared to receiving surgery first. So when it comes to patient characteristics, the factors that we found that were specified by the guidelines for the patients who should receive chemotherapy first were the patients who are older, more frail and had more comorbidities, but there were some variations in how these were defined by the different guidelines. For example, in the American guidelines, age is sort of described as advanced, and it's more yes or no in terms of advanced age, but the European guidelines describe it more as continuous with sort of increasing age. The performance status scores, which have to do with frailty, the word poor was used, but there were no definitions given as to what, for example, performance status scores might constitute poor. And for comorbidities, they were mentioned by all five of these guidelines, but there were no specifics of what actual comorbidities these would refer to and some differences in how they were defined. Some other patient characteristics that were described were poor surgical candidate and high perioperative risks, among others. But once again, there were no clear definitions given as to what these actually meant. Now, there were varying levels of evidence for each of these factors, and the way the different guidelines assessed the levels of evidence and strengths of recommendation varied as well, so they were a little bit difficult to synthesize. So when it comes to disease characteristics, once again, the factors for patients who should receive chemotherapy first that were outlined were those with advanced disease of the epithelial type, and those who are likely to have suboptimal surgical outcomes. But once again, there were some variations in how these were defined by the guidelines. For example, the word advanced was used in all five of the guidelines, but there are variations in how this was defined, ranging from just FIGO stage 3 to 4. Some were more specific with 3C to 4, and some even 2B to 4. All the guidelines agreed on the epithelial type, however, and all the guidelines mentioned sort of suboptimal surgical outcomes, but there were slight variations in how this was defined. So some use the word optimally, which is often defined as that less than 1 centimeter of residual disease. But for example, the European guidelines specify that you should be offering chemotherapy first if you think that the patient's disease will be unable to be debulked completely to no macroscopic visible disease. So there's slight differences between sort of the optimal versus complete debulking there. And once again, there are varying levels of evidence here. The other issue with description of surgical outcomes is that this all has to be determined prior to the actual surgery, because we're trying to decide what pathway the patient should go down. And so the outcome is something that needs to be predicted prior to actually undergoing the procedure. And how we actually predict this depends on investigations and management that the patient receives. So many of the guidelines outline some best practice management pathway decisions, including investigations and treatment that patients should receive to make this decision about which treatment pathway to go down. Some of the factors include specialist and multidisciplinary team management and investigations, including imaging, histopathology, and even diagnostic laparoscopy. Once again, slight variations. So specialist management is described as sort of gynecologist assessment versus a sort of broader description of expertise in a specialist center. And only two of the guidelines actually highlighted the importance of multidisciplinary team management here. There are a variety of imaging modalities recommended, with the combination of ultrasound, CT, MRI, and PET scans recommended. And similarly with histopathology, there were a number of important findings highlighted, but no actual specified thresholds that would make you want to offer a patient chemotherapy first. Three of the guidelines also describe optional diagnostic laparoscopy. And once again, varying levels of evidence. And important to note that our Australian guidelines actually lack any reference to these best practice investigations and treatment pathway options. Something else that's referenced by these guidelines are references to scoring systems that are aimed at trying to predict response to treatment. So trying to turn something that's otherwise fairly subjective into something that's more objective with a scoring system, because we want to determine whether this patient will respond better to chemotherapy first or surgery first. But none of these scoring systems are actually validated and explicitly recommended in the guidelines. So for example, when it comes to response to surgery, there's the Fogarty score, which is a laparoscopic predictive index that's trying to predict the likelihood of optimal debulking. There's also Aledi's and Suidan's scores and models, which are based on imaging findings to try and predict the outcome of the surgery. There's also BOM's chemotherapy response score, which looks at the pathology to try and determine a likelihood of optimal response to chemotherapy. But once again, none of these scores were validated and explicitly recommended in the guidelines that we looked at. So we see that across guidelines, there are some broad similarities in that they seem to suggest that the patients who should receive chemotherapy first are those with advanced epithelial disease, who are older and who are poor surgical candidates, whether that be because of frailty or comorbidities, and those who are likely to have a suboptimal surgical outcome. However, there's no consensus on the definitions, so sort of objective definitions to back up these more subjective descriptions. For example, what stage actually constitutes advanced? What age should be a reasonable cutoff for older patients? What performance status scores make someone too frail? And what actual comorbidities might contribute to this as well? And what investigation findings might make us think that a patient is likely to have a suboptimal surgical outcome? There are also different strengths of recommendations. For example, a study might say that this group should receive chemotherapy first, but other guidelines might say that in this group, you should consider chemotherapy first. And there are also different default treatment pathways. For example, the American guidelines tend to start off with the default of receiving surgery first and then say, in this subgroup of patients, consider chemotherapy first. But the European guidelines sort of define this group should receive chemotherapy first, this group should receive surgery first, and this is the group in between who could receive either. So subtle differences in the approach there. And once again, there was no validated scoring system that was consistently recommended by the guidelines. Perhaps in the future, a standardized scoring system might lead us to a more consistent and objective evidence-based decision-making pathway to decide which patients should go down which pathway of management. So Australia's guidelines lack references to several important aspects of best practice management, including multidisciplinary team management and recommendations for specific investigations. And they were last updated in 2014, so 8 years ago. Recent work, however, in Australia is moving towards more comprehensive recommendations that account for some of these other factors. For example, the National Gynaecology Registry's quality indicators for ovarian cancer treatment. So in conclusion, Australia's guidelines do need to be reviewed so that they can reflect our evolving understanding of the benefits of chemotherapy first in certain subgroups of the epithelial ovarian cancer patient population. I'd like to acknowledge my supervisory team and ENGOR team members, as well as the team at Cabrini. Here are my references, and I am happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. Any questions? Then I'm going to ask one. How do they propose to better address this problem with guidelines? Are they going to just review the data from the National Gynecologic Oncology Registry, or how are they going to do it to be able to create more accurate guidelines?
Yep. So I think one of the things that I found by looking at the different guidelines was that there obviously is a body of evidence that looks at each of these factors. And that's why I sort of described the varying levels of evidence for each of these factors. But even using the same primary studies, the reviews that each of these sets of guidelines were based on sometimes differed in how they were worded. And so I think that really highlighted to us that it tends to be quite subjective. So I think the first important step would be to do a more up-to-date and comprehensive review of what the evidence does say, and a synthesis that way into each of these sort of factors as to, which patients benefit more from chemotherapy first versus surgery first. And then what we are also suggesting potentially is that looking at some of those scoring systems and whether there is a way to make them more objective. So that we can decide which pathway is best for patients to go down. Because otherwise, as I described clinically, it tends to be a little bit based on gut feel and it tends to be a bit subjective as in terms of describing, this patient seems like a patient who would benefit from chemotherapy first, and sort of those more subjective descriptions of, a poor surgical candidate and things like that. So the next step of sort of my project that I was wanting to look at was comparing the data that we've sort of seen here to what we see from the actual National Gynaecology Registry as to which sites are meeting those sort of quality indicators and which patients are receiving chemotherapy first versus surgery first. Yes, I hope that sort of made sense. Sort of two extensions from this project. So one being a more comprehensive literature review and the other being comparing our current clinical practice.
That's okay, I got it.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thanks very much, Yijie. So the next presenter is Roxanne Lim, and she's going to talk about a retrospective review of code grey emergency response calls at Cabrini Malvern.
Hello.
Over to you, Roxanne.
So hi, I'm Roxanne, and today I'll be presenting on a retrospective review of code grey emergency response calls at Cabrini Malvern. And before I begin, I would like to give special thanks to Dr. Martina Wells and Dr. Michael Rose for supporting me and guiding me throughout this project. So just a brief introduction about our topic, which is on healthcare aggression. We all know that healthcare workers are particularly vulnerable to aggression because the hospital can be a stressful, unpredictable, and volatile place. And this can lead to injuries, negative mental health outcomes like burnout, as well as compromise to patient safety. So the Code Grey Standards was introduced in Victoria since 2015 to effectively manage aggressive or violent behaviours in the hospital. And this was also implemented at Cabrini Health in December 2018. So we just wanted to look at some of the Code Grey events to see if we could find any trends or patterns and address them so as to minimise the Code Grey events in the future. Furthermore, we also found that previous studies have mainly focused on violence in public hospitals in pretty specific settings. And we thought that gathering data from a private hospital like Cabrini can help increase data comprehensiveness around this topic. We also took the chance to elucidate some trends pre and post COVID, which could help facilitate discussions on COVID's mental health impact, as well as formulate management strategies. So the aims of our project was to identify demographic, patient, and situational factors of those involved in the Code Grey calls, to elucidate trends in use of psychiatric medications, including antipsychotics, anxiolytics, and mood stabilizers at 3 points of time, namely pre-admission, during inpatient stay, and on discharge, and also to compare any significant trends pre- and post-COVID. So for our methodology, we did a retrospective analysis of 220 Code Grey incidents at Cabrini Malvern, which included 167 patient and 53 non-patient perpetrators. 14 of the patients had multiple codes and 2 passed away during their stay. The timeframes covered for pre- and post-COVID were as follows. And we also recorded the use of psychiatric medications for 115 patients based on admission, inpatient, and discharge medication charts. We also standardized the dosages for antipsychotics and anxiolytics as units of haloperidol and diazepam in milligrams using dose conversion calculators. And for our medication burden analysis, we studied 25 pre and 62 post-COVID patients, excluding patients with Code Grey calls on the day of admission, discharge, and same-day admission. And all data was calculated at a statistical significance of 5%. So just moving on to a bit of some of our findings and also our discussions around them, we'll start off with situational factors which can help us facilitate planning for staffing security and disruptions. So the first situational factor that we looked at was the time of day when the codes happened. So we found that most of the codes occurred in the latter half of the day, particularly in the evening followed by the afternoon. And there were peaks at certain hours, more specifically 2 p.m. and 7 p.m. So we were thinking what happens in the hospital at these 2 hours. And some of the things that we thought about was afternoon handovers and changeover, which occurs at 2 p.m. And we thought that it could be a potential risk factor for reduced attention to patients' needs and disorientation because of the change in staff. For the 7 p.m. peak, we know that sundowning is quite common in patients with dementia, but also we thought about the end of visiting hours, which is at 8 p.m. in Cabrini. And we know that family members will probably leave around 7 to 8 p.m. and that could present an acute change in the patient's immediate support avenues and orientation to familiar people. And this can precipitate confusion and delirium. This was also partially supported by our post-COVID data, which for when visitation is not permitted. And we found a slight drop in the proportions of codes at that time, although that drop was insignificant. We also looked at the locations of the codes. So our top 3 locations were the medical wards, followed by surgical and mixed wards, followed by the ED. in terms of the nature of aggression, 55% involve physical violence, whereas 68% involve verbal or psychological abuse. We also looked at patients versus non-patient perpetrators and found that non-patients were less likely to have physical violence, but more likely to involve verbal or psychological abuse. And that was quite a significant discrepancy. So some reasons we thought for this would be that patients who are sick could have impaired cognitive states, leading to greater disinhibition in behavior and impaired higher order and language function. So because they can't express themselves verbally as well, this can lead to physical manifestations instead. Another reason was also that non-patients might also be bound by tighter socio-legal consequences for their actions and might act more carefully, especially with physical violence. So moving on to demographics, which can advise us on more efficient resource allocation for certain populations. We found that most of the perpetrators were males, which were similar to previous studies. And one of the previous ICU delirium study found that males have an increased susceptibility to hyperactive delirium as compared to females. Females, despite similar rates of mental health comorbidities. We also looked at the patient's age, for which the mean and median were 75 and 79 respectively. And this was higher than data found in previous studies, for which the ages ranged from 25 to 42 years. And this shows that the code gray perpetrators in Cabrini tend to be older. So looking at other patient factors, we looked at the day of admission when the code gray occurred. So the mean and median were days 5 and 2 respectively. And here's just a curve of the frequency. We also looked at the underlying causes and found that delirium and BPSD were the top causes. So 3 in 4 patients displayed signs of delirium around the code period. And this might be attributed to the high proportion of older patients in our cohort as well, who are susceptible to more to such conditions. We also looked at the alcohol involvement in the perpetrators, and it was significantly lower than previous studies. So previous reviews, especially in the ED, had involvement of up to 1 in 2 perpetrators, but our rate was at 3.36%. So this could be attributed to our low proportion of ED codes versus the wards, where alcohol is less accessible and there's a longer lag time with the patient's last use. However, we also acknowledge that our data might not be as accurate because of under-detection or under-declaration, since we used patient reports rather than objective blood tests, breathalyzers, or saliva samples. Our study also found that only 1.68% of patients were COVID patients. We also looked at the primary units of the patients and found that patients were 3.4 times more likely to be under a medical unit versus a surgical unit. And the top 3 unit involvement was gen med, gerontology, and orthopedic surgery, which sort of makes sense because patients in these units tend to have more chronic or palliative conditions and have more precipitating factors. And we know that orthopedic surgery can be quite major, especially stuff like hip replacement is associated with high rates of post-op delirium. And we also looked at the multiple code population and found that 64% had a history of neurological issues and 78% had symptomatic risk factors on admission, which are quite high percentages. We also looked at whether the patients had any surgical procedures prior to their code gray event and found that 31% of patients had recent theatre procedures up to 14 days before, and majority of them were within 5 days post-procedure. And this was backed up by studies that show that delirium is most common early post-surgery, although one good thing was that it's found to have the quickest recovery rate. We were also a bit bewildered by the proportion of surgical to medical patients, because we thought that it was lower than expected, since surgery is quite a major risk factor for delirium. And one of the reasons we thought of was perhaps the lower surgical activity during the COVID lockdowns. But also previous studies have shown that post-op delirium tends to be more hypo than hyperactive manifestations. So this can mean that even if patients have delirium, they're less likely to be aggressive. And so post-op delirium is largely preventable with appropriate care management and close monitoring, which I'm sure Cabrini does provide. Yeah. And even though patients who go through surgical procedures might have a higher susceptibility to severe delirium, because of the sedatives and anesthetics, one study also found that there was no difference to medical patients after adjusting for medications. Now, looking at the non-patient factors, we found that a majority of the initiators were family members, followed by doctors, nurses, non-clinical staff, then public visitors. So most of the grades were instigated by family members presenting with caregiver anxiety. And the top three aggravators were caregiver anxiety, power imbalance, as well as concerns regarding unprofessional service. And caregiver stress is understandably predisposes irritability and reduced patience and overreaction. So one way we thought we could improve this would be through clearer communication, as well as accommodation of reasonable requests where possible. Next, looking at the psychiatric medication use. So we found that pre-admission use of mood stabilizers were the highest, followed by anxiolytics, then antipsychotics. And one in three of our patients who had a code gray have a psychiatric history of mood disorders, which we know is associated with an increased risk of aggressive behavior and poor regulation of emotions. However, this trend was inversed with the inpatient use. So antipsychotics and anxiolytic use were the highest while the patient was in hospital. And it was 71% and 60% respectively, which is pretty high. There was also a significant increase in uptake of antipsychotics on discharge from pre-admission. So this was something that we thought we could explore a bit more, because we know that antipsychotics are often used to symptomatically manage severe agitation during delirium, but it should only be given in the short term or acutely. So we were wondering if it was because the patients needed it before admission but haven't gotten it yet, or are there ways that we can adjust the medication better? We also looked at the medication use in patients with multiple versus single codes, and found that the discharge antipsychotic prescription was 2 times higher. There was also a significantly higher inpatient anxiolytic use. And this again raises the question of whether the code gray was a precipitant or a side effect of the anxiolytic use. Because we know that anxiolytics have a quicker onset of action, but also risk higher incidences of delirium and confusion and should be avoided where alternatives are present. So in all, we thought that the use of psych medications could be looked into a bit more, because studies have shown that drug therapy does not really contribute to the resolution of delirium, which is what most of our code gray patients had. And abstaining from pharmacotherapy can instead provide therapeutic benefit. So ideally, we would want to work towards minimizing the use for the management of code grays, we evaluate whether we need to discharge patients on long-term prescriptions and also improve our non-pharmacological management where safe and possible. And lastly, looking at pre versus post-COVID trends. So post-COVID, we found that the use of psychiatric medications at any point of time was generally higher. And we also found a significantly higher use of mood stabilizers pre-admission during the post-COVID period, which reflects the poorer baseline mental state of patients during this period. However, one good thing that we found was that post-COVID, the median doses of antipsychotics and anxiolytics were decreased on discharge from pre-admission, which is a positive indicator that Cabrini is weaning patients off unnecessary doses of antipsychotics and anxiolytic use, which we know can be bad. Yeah, so just in conclusion, just to summarize the main findings in our study and to have some suggestions, we found that majority of patient code gray calls in Cabrini were instigated by older patients with delirium or dementia in the latter part of the day. So we thought that one thing we could work on was the events where there were temporal associations with. So like afternoon nursing handover, end of visiting hours and sundowning. Perhaps that could be improvements in how it's being conducted, the processes. We also found that the key locations of codes were medical wards, surgical mixed wards, followed by the ED. And perhaps we could accordingly allocate manpower like nursing staff or security to these hotspots. We also found a significantly higher rate of codes from medical patients, more than surgical patients. So perhaps within the medical ward, there can be additional training and screening and anticipating delirium or aggression to prevent the onset of aggressive behaviors. And one possible thing that we could do is also to implement a standardized grading system for patients based on the risk of aggression or delirium as a protocol on the wards, so that the care team can have clearer awareness on who needs closer care or monitoring. We also found that non-patients code gray incidents are mostly attributed to caregiver anxiety. And as mentioned before, clear communication and accommodation of reasonable requests can help reassure them and reduce the anxiety triggers. Our study also found that antipsychotics and anxiolytics are still widely prescribed within our study group. And because we know that it can be futile for delirium and also have detrimental side effects, perhaps stricter protocols and restrictions can help minimize the unnecessary use of such drugs and encourage the engagement of non-pharmacological interventions first. And lastly, to end on a positive note, post-COVID data also showed that Cabrini was good at reducing dosages of some of these psych drugs. But something that we can do to further improve this would be to have de-prescription plans set in place if there's a need to start any antipsychotics or anxiolytics during hospitalization. Thank you. And here are my references.
Thanks very much, Roxanne. Does anyone have any questions for Roxanne? It was a very interesting study. And obviously something that's very important. We hear more code greys being called these days. So very interesting findings. Thanks very much, Roxanne. I'll get you to unshare so we can move on to Chelsea. Chelsea Lim is going to talk today about the Australian-New Zealand Spontaneous Coronary Artery Dissection Registry, a Cabrini sub-study.
Okay, great. So today I'll be presenting on the project I've been working on with my supervisor, Dr. Mukherjee, and this is the Australian-New Zealand Spontaneous Coronary Artery Dissection Registry, the Cabrini sub-study. Starting with a bit of background, spontaneous coronary artery dissection, otherwise known as SCAD, is a condition that plays a significant role in causing acute myocardial infarction, particularly in young females. SCAD is estimated to be the pathology behind 1 to 4% of all AMI events, with a high incidence of around 30% in women who are aged under 50. And unlike the typical demographic of patients who experience most AMI events, SCAD has a strong female predominance, with up to 90% of cases being in women, and the majority are young and healthy without any cardiovascular risk factors. SCAD is a universally under-recognized and under-researched condition with minimal existing evidence in this area. So just a bit about SCAD itself. It's a non-atherosclerotic cause of AMI. The pathophysiological process is outlined in the diagram here. It involves a disruption in the coronary artery wall, such as a tear or a bleeding from the vasa vasorum, and this results in the intima separating from the other layers. An intramural hematoma is formed and a false lumen is created, which can then lead to occlusion of the coronary artery. So the aim of our study is to identify Cabrini patients presenting with SCAD retrospectively over the last 10 years, and we aim to determine the prevalence of SCAD at Cabrini. The study will also form a subset of the Australian New Zealand SCAD Registry, also known as the ANZ-SCAD Registry. This is a national registry that aims to improve the diagnosis, treatment, and prevention of SCAD. This larger study will also focus more specifically on outcomes of SCAD, such as looking at patients who are managed conservatively versus with revascularization, and also determine the incidence of impaired left ventricular ejection fraction post-SCAD, and look at the uptake of optimal medical therapy. So the records of 88 women who underwent coronary angiogram at Cabrini Health for AMI with admission since 2014 were retrospectively reviewed to identify any patients who were diagnosed with SCAD. Patients were included if they were female, aged between 18 to 75, and they had angiogram findings available. The angiogram results were then analysed to identify SCAD patients, and the details of these patients, their presenting episode, and their outcomes are also entered into the ANZ-SCAD registry database. This is a decision tree outlining the inclusion and exclusion process. We use the ICD codes I21 and I22 to find patients with AMI. Then after applying the inclusion and exclusion criteria, we ended up with a total of 85 patients in our study population. So looking at these 85 patients, the mean age was 62.4 years, and there were 6 patients in our cohort who were aged under 50, making up 7.1% of our study population. Looking more closely at the diagnoses in the cohort, the majority of patients were diagnosed with an NSTEMI at a percentage of 67.1. 10.6% of patients had a STEMI diagnosis, 7.1% with SCAD, and 15.3% with other. Looking more closely at the SCAD results, our study showed an overall prevalence of 7.1%, and specifically in the patients who were aged under 50, 2 of the 6 patients were diagnosed with SCAD, which results in a prevalence of 33.3% in the subgroup. This is just a table that briefly outlines in a bit more detail the 6 SCAD patients. You can see that they presented with a variety of presenting symptoms. In terms of management, 5 were medically managed and 1 patient underwent PCI. The left ventricular ejection fraction was largely normal, aside from 1 patient who had mild to moderately reduced function. And in terms of outcomes, we had no deaths, no patients experienced a SCAD recurrence, and there was 1 patient that was subsequently diagnosed with fibromuscular dysplasia. As the larger ANZ-SCAD study progresses, we hope to be able to produce more results that will look more specifically at the presentation management and outcome of SCAD patients across Australia and New Zealand. So the SCAD prevalence of 7.1% found by our study is comparable to the findings of other similar studies. A systematic review by Hayes et al. Reports that SCAD was responsible for 1 to 4% of all ACS events. The high prevalence that we found in younger women was also evident in other studies, and our result of 33.3% is relatively similar to findings from these existing studies. And they report quite a varied range of prevalences from between 8.7% to 35%. And our result lies in the higher end of this range, which may indicate that Cabrini is performing well in identifying and diagnosing SCAD. The current evidence base still does show that SCAD is likely an underdiagnosed condition globally, including at Cabrini, which could be contributed to by many factors, such as the relative rarity of the condition and also the age and gender bias. The 6 SCAD patients that we found in our sub-study have also been included in the ANZ-SCAD registry. And just a bit more about the registry itself. So it's an observational multi-centre clinical registry that will take place between March 2021 and February 2026. The aim is to recruit 850 SCAD patients, both prospectively and retrospectively. And the study will focus on the following research questions. Firstly, what is the best way to diagnose SCAD? When should SCAD be managed medically, and when does revascularization improve outcomes? Should all SCAD survivors be given dual antiplatelets and statins? And what are the predictors of acute SCAD progression and long-term recurrence? The current SCAD registries globally include the Canadian SCAD registry, the European SCAD registry that's currently recruiting, and the Victor Chang Institute has also looked at a patient cohort focused on underlying genetic conditions in SCAD, such as fibromuscular dysplasia. So this study will also contribute to international data pooling in order to produce comparative studies. So in conclusion, in a single centre, the prevalence of SCAD is similar to global estimates, although it is important to note that we did analyse a small number of patients in our study. Further analysis of conservative versus invasive treatment of SCAD, the outcomes in these patients post-PCI or CABG, the incidence of impaired left ventricular ejection fraction post-SCAD, and the use of optimal medical therapy in this cohort will be of value to the study. There's very limited research in this area, and existing studies do acknowledge the difficulty in determining the true prevalence of this condition. And the ANZ-SCAD registry aims to describe the clinical presentation, management, outcomes, and predictors of acute deterioration and recurrence in a large SCAD cohort. And we hope to have some preliminary results from the registry in the near future. So these are just my references here. And that's the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your time, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thanks very much, Chelsea. Another great presentation. Are there any questions for Chelsea?
How many patients has Chelsea had a stent as part of their prior to the initial diagnosis? Do you have numbers for that in Cabrini and Australia-wide?
So unfortunately, I'm not too sure about Australia-wide. Hopefully those results will come through, as they start analysing some of the findings that we've entered into the registry database. But I believe at Cabrini, of our 6 patients, there was one patient who underwent a PCI. I think they were the one patient that was diagnosed with a STEMI on admission, and the other 5 patients all medically managed.
Thanks, Chelsea. And thank you to all of the students today who have presented. Once again, great presentations, very high quality. Well, we had a fantastic response to the annual Cabrini Research Forum, and a significantly large number of people that went and looked at all of the posters and voted, which was fantastic. So without further ado, we'll go to the first award. Is the award for medical or other student undertaking a research scholarship or honours degree. And the winner is Yijie, who's online today. Patient selection for interval debulking surgery in ovarian cancer, a review of current guidelines. So Yijie only has to pay us $400 to get her award. Only kidding, that's the award. And the runner-up is Denise Tong for reconciliation of medical records and review of opioid prescribing at Cabrini Health, and she receives $150. We'll move on to the next award, which is students undertaking a higher degree study, master's or PhD. And the winner of this is Neville Fields. Neville Fields presented on CoSprout, a pilot double-blinded randomized controlled trial of broccoli sprout for pregnant women with COVID-19. And the runner-up was Natalie Smith-Diaz, who presented an opportunity to improve patient outcomes via pharmacist-led medical education, a physiotherapist perspective. So congratulations to both of those winners. Next is clinicians stepping into research. And the winner was Daryl Thompson. And Daryl presented on patients reported reasons for accepting or declining a testicular prosthesis following orchidectomy, a survey of Australian patients. And the runner-up is Emily Sneap, who presented recall, reliability of estimates of clinicians' lung cancer caseload, a comparison of clinical estimates of key study eligibility criteria with data from the INHALE registry. The next one is early career researchers, and the winner was Steve Fuchs. Exercise for the prevention of anthracycline-induced functional disability and cardiac dysfunction. The 12-month breast cancer randomized exercise intervention study, Brexit. And runner-up was Dillis Leung, biobank of breast cancer organoids as a reliable drug testing platform. And the final one's pretty embarrassing. I had to vote for myself 3,000 times to actually beat Eva for this. And I'm very happy to donate my money back into Cabrini Research. This is an experienced researcher, and I had a number of phase one presentations. This one was a phase one safety and tolerance study of FN1501, a novel FLT3 inhibitor in patients with advanced solid tumours and acute myeloid leukemia. We recruited a large number of patients to that study through the medical oncology unit, and the runner-up was Eva Zopp, our exercise scientist. For perceptions of exercise in people with advanced cancer and cachexia, a qualitative study. Is that the end? Oh, there's People's Choice Award, yep. Okay, so People's Choice, almost 400 votes were cast, and the winner was David Chiang. The effects of habitual coffee consumption on incident cardiovascular disease, arrhythmia and mortality, long-term outcomes from a UK biobank. So congratulations, David. And there were honourable mentions to Melissa Verica, Melissa Lee, Roxanne Lim, Christine Georges, and the lucky voter was Alan Tai. So I think that comes to the end of the awards. I would like to congratulate all of the winners, but more importantly, congratulate all of the people that submitted presentations to the annual symposium. It has been a great success, and we're very happy with the format, and we will continue this next year.